So Split Eyes is actually that. If you have 10 people on the song, yeah, right, writing the same song, they must have an equal amount to that 50%. So if you have 10 people writing lyrics to your song, they must share the 50% on author.
And then what about the situation where I pay the musician to compose? Is that possible?
The lyricist.
So that I can own the
That's actually another topic that we're going to touch on. People can, and it's always been done in history, pay for people to, it's what they call ghostwriting, ghost producing, whatever. So somebody's paying you to say, okay, you're going to compose this, but I'm not going to give you a future of the album. I don't know if I'm making sense. So in other words, you don't have any splits. You just play for me, and I pay you this amount of money, and that's it. But usually with that, it's tricky, because some people know how much some music is going to be worth in the long run. So I wouldn't want to cheat myself out of that. I wouldn't want to cheat myself out of bread and butter. 10 years from now, your song could be worth millions, and I sold that thing to you. I don't have any share of that million. You see what I'm saying? So usually if they do agree, they will ask for a huge amount. If they do agree. Some will say, okay, cool, give me 100,000. I'll write the song and I'll never take credit for it. But you must also have that in mind. Not just a verbal agreement. So to your question, yes, it's done, that's possible, it's very possible, but it's a huge debate that you probably want to get lawyers involved as well if you're going to do that type of route. Personally, I wouldn't advise it for any songwriter. If you're a songwriter, even if you think that artist is struggling, never give away your rights. Because that song, even 20, 30, 40 years from then, you never know when it's going to blow up. Like, you could write a song now, and it only makes billions in 20 years from now. Now imagine you sold your writing rights. You lost a share of billions. It never makes sense to sell your share at all. Rather ask for a minimal amount and then sell a minimal portion.
Yeah.
So instead of saying, okay, CJ, give me 50,000, but I'm only selling 20% to you. So I keep my 30%, and then that 50,000 only gives you 20%. Most also touched on that topic. There's a huge debate I've actually heard in the past. If you come to me as a producer, and you come to me and you say, play a melody for me, and then you hum the melody, and I play exactly what you hum, there's this debate that because I played it, everyone should have a split. It's not the case. I didn't compose that. I just played what you told me to play, so technically you're the composer. And when that happens, when I'm done playing, I'm going to realize, wait, I don't have a share in this. So how do I get something out of this? Usually that's the way I want an upfront fee. Okay, I'll charge you a certain amount for playing this thing for you. It's a once-off fee. You can do that. Any question on that topic, actually? Okay, so split shares, like I said, once you're done with that song, you've got two people that wrote on that song, and then you've got one person who composed the actual melodies, right? There's 50%, and then you have your 25% because you shared it with another songwriter, right? You have the 25%, and the other songwriter has the 25%. So in total, this whole thing is worth 100%, right? You must have that split sheet, and then you must put it in writing, and then share it with the people that you wrote it with. So when you later on go to Samro to register the song, whatever you guys agreed on is what you put on Samro. If you go and write something different, which most artists do, they take those chances. They get there and then they write, no, I wrote the whole song alone. I composed the whole song alone. This is where those split sheets will protect you. Because you're going to go and register that song, and then 3 years from now, I know the song is a hit. And then I ask myself, but why don't I have royalties that I wrote on that song? And I can go to Samro and say, no, CJ wrote the song with me. He has the split sheets. So it's important to have split sheets when you guys are working with your friends. Even your friends, especially your friends. especially the friends. The friends are the ones that usually do something. They write a song with him, they write something different and stuff. So don't do the whole, no, he's my friend, he'll never do 1, 2, 3. No. Put it on paper. Those speeches that I'm talking about. It'll then get us to that summer conversation that I'll get there. This part I already covered, where if somebody asks to buy a certain composition. Oh, by the way, if you have a song and I like the song and I want a share in the song, I'd usually, even if I haven't wrote anything and I didn't produce anything, I can offer you money and say, please give me a share of the song. People could do that. Most record labels actually do that. If you've seen album covers in the back, there's a part that says executive produced by. And it's like one person's name, and then sometimes they'll have two executive producers. Usually the reason they have two, the one is the guy that owns the record company that's producing the music. So he's an executive because he paid for it to happen. And then the other executive is usually the creative guy. So CJ can appoint somebody else to be the creative guy. So you can appoint somebody to be the guy that gets the right musicians, that gets the right producers for this thing. That's an executive. So there's two types. Like I said, if I decide I hear your song and I like your song and I want to share it, I can come to you and say, hey CJ, I'll give you 50,000, I'll give you 25% of your song.
Just anybody randomly.
Anybody. And then those names you put in speeches. But never sell other people's share. I don't know if I make sense. So if I like your song, the only share you are allowed to sell is the one that belongs to you. You can't sell me the other producers. Selling the producer's share without his knowledge. You can only sell your share. If you feel like, hey, I can get money out of more money from this guy, call the producer, tell him, hey, there's this guy who's buying a share of my, maybe you're interested in him buying your share. There's that topic as well. And whatever you guys agree on, put it on the split sheet. Now you have a third guy on the split sheet who wasn't even on the song, but because he paid for the share, he's now there. Take those things. Because people do that. Like, I can hear a song and I know this is going to be a hit for the next 3, 4, 5 years. I want my money in there as well. It's an investment. Yeah. So, yeah, people can do that. I hope I answered you.
Yeah.
Right. I think I'm done with the recording part and speech sheets. Is there anything else you guys want to ask in this section? Or number one, Marketing. All right. So marketing, back in the day, I know you guys have seen it. I've seen these things in movies as well. You have a CD band, you go get it printed, and then you put the music on CDs and put it in the back of your boot. And you drive to each city that you know that you have people that you can show your music. This is the old way of doing it. Now we have social media. That is your social media is your boot. You must always use your boot. So in other words, have Instagram, have Twitter, have whatever else, like Facebook. If you have WhatsApp, even better. These social media platforms, they are your boot. You are now done with your product. That's what you sell it. And you must sell it every day. You don't say, I'll sell it just once a month. It's not gonna move. Remember those guys that used to sell CDs back in the boot? You saw them at the corner of Pretoria every day, right? Yeah. Exactly. If you see them every day, it's the same thing you do on social media. You post every day. So that's where your fans are now. They're no longer in the streets waiting for you to come and see them. They're on social media waiting for you to tell them where to get your music. That's how that whole situation is. So it's important when it comes to marketing. I'm not a marketing guru, guys, but there's very easy ways of getting stuff out there. Facebook and Instagram, even Twitter now, they have post boost. So you guys can set aside an amount of money, 600 grand, whatever you have on your pocket. This is your petrol that you were using to go to town to advertise your music every day. Instead of taking the petrol and putting it in your car, take that petrol now, convert it to Facebook marketing, said this little thing, you go to when you post your album on Instagram, there's a little button, a blue button that says boost post. When you click that thing, it allows you to put the amount of money that you want to spend. And it's every time you move it up, it tells you this is the amount of money you're spending and this is how many fans you will reach. So every time you do that, that's what you do. So take that money, put it into boosting this app. When you boost it, it's going to show on social media every day. Every day. Now, I know most guys will be like, oh, no, but that's the record company's like job. It's really not. Because remember, they have an investment of money they put on. If it's a major record label, they want that money. Whether you think they should sell it or not, it's up to you to sell yourself. You must sell yourself. I don't know if I'm going to say. If you do want a company, a record company, to assist you on marketing, talk to your record company. Guys, I want to have assistance in marketing. This is how much I would need every month. Guarantee the company that this thing will work. Show them numbers. It's easy to show the numbers as well. Just go to the Facebook post thing and say, no, if I put X amount of money, it will give me X amount of people listening to my music, which therefore in 4 or 5 months I'll get X amount of money back. And you get your marketing money back. Whatever the case is, whatever deal you have with your income. But ultimately, if you own this music independently, it's your baby. There's nobody else to take care of your function. Okay, equally so. Spotify is very, very big on marketing musicians, especially upcoming musicians. But they won't do it if you don't have a proper social media page. So if you don't have a proper page that you run on your Instagram, your Twitter, and whatnot, they won't even pay attention to you and you might just send music to them to put on pages. So Spotify, how it works. If you are about to release a song 3 weeks from now, right? Spotify will see that you are about to release a song. They will give you an option, there's a button that says submit for playlisting. When you click that button, then you choose the song that you want them to use to market your stuff and put on playlist. Right? So when you do that, what's important for you is why your social media is up to date. If it's not up to date, you won't even consider it. If you don't even have a bio Spotify, you can consider yourself. If there's not a single photo, I'd suggest that you have minimum of the photos on Spotify. If you don't have photos on your Spotify, they won't even consider it. Now, playlists are very important, especially with Spotify because you don't pay for them. On Spotify, it's absolutely free. You don't pay for this. You just need to make sure your bio is on par, social media is on par, and then they'll consider putting your music on page. Now, if you push a song now and it gets released in 3 weeks from now, without playlisting, you'll probably do, how many fans do you have on your Facebook? Let's see. 2,000. How many interact on your page daily? Because remember, you can have 2,000 people, but only like 600 people are viewing. Yeah. So if you have 600 people viewing your music, it means you most likely will have 600 people playing. For you to increase your chances to be played out to a bigger market, you need to be on playlist. So if you get accepted on playlist, you might end up on a playlist that's reaching out to fans in Nigeria, in UK, whatever the case is, if you're on playlist. Now you get more numbers. So instead of doing the 600 numbers that you were doing each month, you're now doing 3,000 numbers. 3,000 new people are listening to your stuff. It's not your Facebook fans. It's absolutely and how you guys are gonna get your music on Spotify is making sure your social media is up to date. You have bios. Bios is that thing that say, I am so and so, I started making music at this time, blah, blah, blah. I have this if you have achievements, let's get from you. And you sort of invite. Is there any questions on that? Any questions? Then you have, I'm moving on to the section called distribution. Distribution is the part now you're using the line, you the spirits, you make sure everybody knows what they're about to get with the pop songs. You now have to distribute the music. There's different channels to do that. If you're with a major record label, they know how to get music onto Apple Music, Spotify, they own way, however way. If you're an independent artist or independent record label, there's independent distributor out there. I will name just a few for you guys. There's a lot, but I'll just name a few. There's Digital Music, there's Level Music, there's TuneCore, there's CD Baby. All of these things are distributors, right? And all of them work differently. Some will ask you for each release that you put out, they want $400. And then you never have to do it. Some of them will ask you for $20,000 per year, and then each year you can release whatever amount of music you want to release. Will be covered in that $200,000. And the next day comes, you pay $200,000 for it. If you don't pay that amount, they remove your music from Apple Music, Spotify, blah, 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 and so forth. Right? So, alright. Some companies, I'll name CD Baby for instance, because I'll actually work. CD Baby will charge you a once-off fee. They will charge you $400,000 for each album that you release, but they ask for 10% of your publishing. So in other words, when you collect your royalties, you're not collecting 90%. You're collecting 90%. And once you've collected that 90%, you go back to those speed sheets. Remember those speed sheets that you guys made? That's how you distribute your speeds. Now. You can do it yourself, or some companies like when you put the part, like who produced it, then you put the amount of percentage based on the spreadsheet. Then everything will pay out based on that. So it's the same concept that you use on Samba. That you're using on distribution. The distribution is quite an easy, short chapter. Are there any questions on distributing your music? Everybody knows how to distribute music. You know how to distribute music. Okay. Okay. All right. I'm going to move to publishing. Publishing is, okay, how publishing started back in the day. They used to just publish lyrics. So if you had an album and there were lyrics in, they would actually sell the lyric book to your album. So publishing started like that. It was just publishing the lyrics. Now they actually publish the music itself. Now, why is publishing important in this day and age? In this day and age, publishing is like, remember that guy that came in and bought your splits? Yeah. If he buys your splits, he's not obligated to sell your music. Not obligated to market to anyone, right? But when he's a publisher, it's important for them. If I'm a publisher and I come to you, or you come to me, vice versa, right? If I'm a publisher and you have a song now, right? You want me to publish that song. It's important for me to then sell the music to the public so I can get my share of that music. So in other words, the guy that came earlier to buy your share, he doesn't have to earn his 25%. But a publisher, there's no money involved. I'm not gonna make sense. So if you come to me and you have a song, and I say I'll publish that song for you, I want 10%. I must work for my 10%. You see what I'm saying? So I'll put it out wherever I want to put it out, so I make sure I earn my 10%. So if I publish where your music on a TV show or whatever, and you make 100 grand out of that, great business to keep going, and you go split it amongst the people that you work with. So publishing is something that most of you guys need to consider, because publishing will put your music in revenues or places that you couldn't before. TV shows, movies, adverts. You guys probably heard that little drama about Questa and the Telkom deal. Somebody published the song and sent it to Telkom, but someone else went aware that the song was now being published with somebody else, and instead to all the men to each other. So, in publishing, there's three types of publishing. The first one is, I'm going to start at the top with the normal pure publishing, which is the one where you come to me and I ask for 10% and you agree, and then I start distributing the music where I need to distribute it, and then I take 10% of that. That's the normal publishing stream. Then there's co-publishing. Co-publishing means whatever revenues or whatever money I use to make sure that the music is where it needs to be, you must match the amount that I use for making that music. So in other words, if I'm planning on using to market your music so I can get my 10% worth, I need you to give me 100 grand as well, so I can push with a bigger budget. That's core publishing. Then you get administrative publishing. Administrative publishing is a very famous one right now. Administrative publishing, usually, their biggest job is to take care of you immediately. So every time you guys have a song with whoever you have a song, that guy is going to sit on your neck. Ask you where this pitch is. So when you go to studio with, I'll make an example, which big artist do you want to work with?
Damien
Mali. If you go to Damien Mali and I'm your administrative publisher, right? You don't have to stress about talking business, because I know how some artists don't like talking business. You take that business to your administrative publisher and he will do the business on your behalf. So it takes care of you. Ranges from 15 to 20 or 10. It honestly depends. If you go to Samro, the normal publishing split is 32%. But most guys really use a smaller percentage because they want to have more artists anyway. So they use a smaller percentage because they know they want to get more artists in the long run and not just focus on you. So focus on you, don't do this, artists. So they have a bigger scale that they're working with, right? So administrative publishing is exactly that. When you get to studio, you work with whoever you want. Then you tell that guy, if you have a business manager or whatever, talk to my publisher. Then they deal with the business part of it. Especially if you guys don't want to charge each other. That's another thing. Usually when people work, they have to charge each other. Right? Because I can't imagine saying to CJ, CJ, I want to work with you on the song, right? Come to Pretoria. Who's funding the trip? Is what I said. So it's important to charge. So you can charge for the transportation, and charge for food, and charge for wherever you stay, whatever the case is, right? But obviously there's communication in there as well. If some people say, I want you to come work with me, they'll say, oh no, I'll pay for your transportation, I'll pay for this. So you don't have to talk about fees. And the only thing you guys talk about is at the end of the day. But like I said, if you don't want to talk business with that person, send it to your administrator. Is there any question on communication? All right, song registration. When you guys know all these steps that we talked about from recording, so who owns the master? From the composition, who owns the composition, to the authorship and whatnot. CJ, this is your topic. So when you now have everything done, you register the song, everybody knows how much they're getting out of it from the royalty splits. This is where Samro comes in. Samro, by the way, before I continue, Samro is not a record label's responsibility. As an artist, you must register your song. Back in the day, you used to be able to register on somebody's behalf. It's no longer a thing. They don't want that. Everybody must, as a composer, I must be registered with Samro, right? So the reason you've registered with Samro is Samro must know that you exist. And they must know that you're a composer, you're a songwriter, you're a producer, da da da. It's all in those forms, right? So when I come one day and I make a song with you, I must put that composer name there. When I submit it to someone, they know you exist because you're a DJ. You see? So it's important for everybody to register with someone. If you're working independently, so in other words, you are your own record label, it's also important to register with Visa. Visa are the guys that do ISRC codes. ISRC codes are the things that they use. It's a number, it's a long number. It's like 12 pages long. They use that to track your music on TV shows, radio stations, and all of that stuff. If you own the master or you are the master holder, you have to register with Visa so you can get an ISRC code. But if you're a record company, yes, do your song, the record company will submit and they will give you an ISRC code. So the Visa part is not that tricky. You don't even have to do it yourself. Somebody can do it on your behalf. It doesn't need to be there. But Samro, it must be you. Strictly you. And then there's Capasso. Capasso as well. You must register yourself as the. As a composer, as a partner. Yeah, you need to register with Capasso as well. Capasso is similar to Summer, but they hold the different types of your rights. So in music, there's a lot of rights, but the three main ones, or the two main ones, sorry, there's performance rights and there's needle time rights. Needle time rights is the one that are registered by Apple Music, Spotify, TV shows, radio, so the needle time. So every time it spins, they take that amount of money and they put it onto Samro. And Samro will split according to your splits, right? And then your performance, that's the one that Capasso would normally take care of. So when you're performing live and you're playing as you perform a song, this is another thing that people actually don't do. How many of you, by show of hand, when you're performing live, at the end of the year, you submit a list of the songs that you perform live to Samro or Capasso? No. Here's why that's important. You're missing out on money that belongs to you. So even if I'm a DJ, right, and I compose my own songs, and I DJ my own songs in party and wherever I'm booked, there's money that Capasso can actually generate and get for me. If I submit the page. So from now on, you guys, man, when you're performing wherever, doesn't matter, birthday party, whatever, that, you know, when you see a CD and it says, rights belongs to for performances, right? You've seen that on the CD somewhere, right? So that's the reason for you when you perform in a birthday party, for instance, and you perform that song, but you don't register that day, the performance. Capasso won't give you a 12 cents. And now most of you will be like, 12 cents, it's a lot of money. Spotify and Spotify is paying 4 cents per stream. So every time the song plays on Spotify, it's only giving you 4 cents. Right? But there's people that are moving this from Spotify too, because every time it's paid. Right? But when you're playing live, this is why I'm saying it's important for you guys to submit those lists. When you go to a party today and you perform your own song, put it on the playlist. Right? And then at the end of the year, go to somewhere and submit all the songs that you performed that whole year. So they know when they have to collect performance rights from clubs and whatever and all of that. On that slip, by the way, you must say where you perform. Because I'm going to make an example now. When you go to clubs, Use Cafe, for instance, Use Cafe pays what they call a user's license. They must pay that license in order for them to actually be permitted to play your music. I don't know if I can say that. If a club plays music but they don't have a license, it's illegal. They must always have a license, which they pay an amount of money to Samro, Capasso every year to use your music, right? So now let's say those guys play your song, right? And they're not registered with Capasso or Samro. You're not going to collect on those money because they don't have license to use your music. So it's important for the club that you're performing to for them to have a license to perform for using the music, right? And it's also important for you to also submit the music that you played at that club so they know, okay, the club did pay an X amount. part of mine this year. And because for these artists that perform here, here, that playlist that you submit every year is what's going to help them know what belongs to you. So from now on, guys, whenever you perform, ask the places that you're performing at, do they have a license to play music? Because when you're performing music, you are playing music, right? It's usually going to be a yes or no answer, usually. So if it's a yes, then you know you can put it on your sheet and say, I performed at Music Cafe, and I performed this song, and this song, and this song, and this song, and this song. So when Music Cafe plays their license to someone, there's an X amount of money waiting for you from that line. Even if it's just possible. I can imagine if you're performing in a year. If you perform, what, a million times, how much is that? It's 12 cents. And that you guys have been missing out on. So from now on, guys, if you're an artist and you perform somewhere, write it down where you perform, what venue you are, if they have a license or not, and then submit that every year. So you know you can do that. So that's what our password is. Yeah, I think that's actually it. Is there any questions on that section? Yes.
Capasso.
No, Capasso is the one I actually
used. The performance?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I wanted to understand on how do we put them, the performances on the playlist.
It's a sheet of paper. I think you can get it on those websites as well, but even your own sheet of paper that states, I performed this song at this club, and then when you with those companies, you can ask them how to actually put those players out. Especially DJs. DJs have players, but they also do something to submit those players.
So, even if they are licensed or not,
yeah, you can still submit, because if that place decides to get a license later on, they can still do a catch-up.
Do they have to pay for it?
Yeah, license
is pay. Pay for the license.
Yeah, license is pay. So as a club owner and you have a license to play music, you pay for it again. I can't remember the exact amount, but it's usually like 400, 500. And if you're a DJ, you're paying about 800 to 900 grand per year. And then you just do whatever you're going to play. Because technically, if you don't have a DJ license, for instance, and you start playing other people's music, it's illegal. If you don't have a DJ license, it's illegal to play other people's song. The same way if you have a club, if you have a club and you play other people's music, technically you're a DJ, because you play other people's music, right? You must have a license for that. Like a TV license. It's a similar concept. TV licenses, that's where actually most of our money comes from. When you get a check coming from SABC, it's these TV licenses. And because TV license covers radio as well. Radio can collect from TV licenses. Is there any other questions?
Maybe just to add on the playlist, yes. It's your own set list. So wherever you perform, even your own piece of paper, you can write wherever you write.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. This is Lutamba, this track, and Mfazo Rasta, your computer.
And then they
will tell you the process. I don't want to lie on that part.
Yeah, because I don't understand. Yeah. Where am I writing? I'm writing on a piece of paper.
Yeah, you can write it on a piece of paper. Mm-hmm. If you're scared to lose the paper, that's what you're talking about. Just take a photo.
Oh, I should keep the paper.
You should keep the paper or take a photo of it, and then, at the end of the year, then you submit.
I've submitted at the end of the year.
Yeah. It's usually a yearly thing.
I don't submit like the after every performance.
No. It's a yearly submission.
So how do they know if the performance
was what?
If the performance was real.
That's why I remember, if it's not in collision with the fact that you perform somewhere that they have a license holder, if it doesn't reflect, it will just ignore it. It will reflect. Because remember, if you go to News Cafe, they have a DJ license and whatever license, right? They will also do state that they did have a CJ performing there. something similar to them every year as well. So you can't make up gigs because it has to match. It has to match the person that booked you. The person that booked you usually will also have. Usually, if it's a club, they will have something they submit as well.
Or like
event organizers. Yes,
they should also have like
usually they do that.
I have another question. I think it's about Greece. I don't know.
Okay.
When, let's say from the artist and the record company, mm-hmm. after the split, mm-hmm. and then usually where artists struggle to, I don't know if it's about license in publishing the product. Publishing on your Facebook.
Yeah, you mean the marketing part, yes.
Yeah. And then you're doing that, but then you're not allowed to do that. Because people will be telling you that the license.
But so, wait, I'm assuming, are you talking about when you want to publish, you took a video, then you put a song on it, right? And then you publish it like on Facebook, then it says you're not the copyright holder.
Usually muted.
They're usually muted, 100%. So that's usually when it's coming from a holder that's not associated with the right holder of that song. So you as CJ and you play my record song on the video, they will mute it. But let's say hypothetically speaking, you did have the rights to play my record stuff. Then you would have a paperwork of some sort, a contract of some sort.
Yeah, and what if it's my song? What if it's my song that I'm trying to?
You can dispute it. You can dispute it. That actually has personally happened to me. You can dispute it and write, because there's this section that you can write and dispute that it is your song. So in your case, let's say you're using material that is under our company, right? Azambi. You can say, no, I'm the artist that works with Azambi. If they need extra thing, they'll maybe even contact us. Then we'll just give you documents. Or you, vice versa, to just prevent being asked, you can ask for a paperwork. This is actually, that's actually a nice question, because now it landed us back to paperwork. Paperwork is important, guys. If you're working with a record company, paperwork is important. Even if you have a verbal agreement that you guys want to work, translate that into paperwork for that type of scenario. Because Facebook is not going to say, did you have verbal agreements with the record label that holds the rights to this music? They're not going to ask you that. They're going to ask you for a scanned paperwork of your contract with the company. I don't know if I'm interested.
Yeah.
And actually, that also leads us to, I'll use an example with Tihon Busani's work. There's a song that your father gave you guys. I just can't remember what it's called. Drink and Drive. Yeah. There's a song that was passed down from one right holder to another right holder. So he was reluctant to say, no, but it's my song and I'm giving it to my daughter. Which is fair. It's his song and he wants to give it to his daughter. But it has to be on paper for this reason. When I'm distributing the music, which is the case and it happened, when I'm distributing the thing, the music, and it stays there in the bracket that the cover, I must now have paperwork that goes along with it. That's why I insisted and I had a conversation with them and I said, there needs to be paperwork that you need to sign so they know that you now move ownership from you, yourself to them. You see? Because here's what happened. If hypothetically speaking, that song, if that song, hypothetically, he gave it to us to use, but there was no paperwork. And then later on, your father decides he wants to get Sony involved. In other words, he wants his catalog, his earlier catalog, to be sold to Sony. Right? That song would happen to be in that catalog. Now Sony has the rights to that catalog, right, that has Drink and Drive. Sony can come at us and say, we're suing you for doing this song without our permission, because now they own the copyright, right? But if we have paperwork, which in this case we do, we can present the paperwork. No, the artist gave us the permission when it was belonging to him. Then Sony can back off. But if there's no paperwork, they won't back off. The same with that Facebook situation. If it asks for paperwork and you don't provide paperwork, it will mute the sound, even if it's your song, because there's no paperwork. That's why it's important to have paperwork. So in your case, it will just say, it's a small paperwork. It doesn't have to be a huge contract. Nobody likes doing huge contracts. It can be one page. That's just say, CJ, hi CJ, recorded this song with Azambi Music Academy, da 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 da. And then you have the Azambi Music record label manager to sign it, and you sign it yourself. And next time you upload a song that belongs to you, that's recorded with us, and then you want to any questions on that? Is there no questions at all? Is everybody comfortable with this whole conversation? So the next time we have a similar workshop, we're actually going to try to get you guys people from Samo, people from yourself, so that you can give you guys more information. But if you do have questions, maybe you can shoot them to them. That's all, guys, from me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Baba Pedro, yes. Oh, una mumwe ane ufana na Rothman ane azuti. Ogo dinyago explain nelonga. Attention yopelea. Okay. So about the split Rothero face asati. Or usplita u owner the copyright. Nazori pambano between a record label and company. Zo pambana gai Rothero kosi diwati. Okay. I've been coming by some of the of Marais named via workshop. So I don't have a name with this, so in the I could dash in. It appeared that after not here, which could have a number of people, but we never could get a cash. We good. Are we good or we hungry? Okay. Rekoli war dog for our share as we as diva. Is there anyone an Akonyago Eda, Namanyago Eda? For Zunia foreign is one day for the Bangladeshi Dive. Nina Konyago Shera, something. At a 9 month of age, you never go from with Wama Rotary Shapuzian. Okay, Kofuka Kais. Zunia's acquainted at the Azimon. Though on a performance at Cairo, Mara, not now. The Tomarala, then Richikola, the Arkulug is a set up with a Cairo Afanon or a Cairo at the Arthur for my album. I will drop yesterday. Love, if it's too late, you go on a car or digital platforms. So, Naira is the Rimara Shara, trust subscribe and at the end of the Music Academy YouTube channel. So, Udovakuri give up 3 songs or 4 the Dovakai. 5 years. Okay. Ofi vibe ya one dot enda di 5. Zama zo dori fatere ke tano. Mara ndiam sirono alati. Aunga dova na zimwe zito from now on. Oh again. Kaya yose tene la dova rei set up ano. If richi kola apu awona mwa ane ako fori. Aunga zitu kairwa ye. Tena nene kunya go showa case. or in the basin bedore in a junior. I think it's in the opportunity to imbed our tubane. I was a good beat to one with the ear will be paying attention for it. Niko imba mini, nina voice. So, Rishap or Upisa our to music, whatever they will pay attention. So, Erdoarala, Rifa Zola, Rauya. I don't think Rdo was one of a professional like this. So, Rdo was one of an energy. Oyo Anokopori, Udo Yagova party a performance. While we'll be eating, Kadam, Ankwame, and Sende, maybe two songs or one. Then in the Wandiko Z compiler, Rudolph Fudoko Z compiler, the creative performer is done. We good?
Yes.
Okay. And we are not in the rear of everybody, not only five. But we're not doing that. I think it's fine.
Ringayan, there are one we can move around.